So, well, we'll get started. I'm Erica from the Little River Institute. I think everybody knows that, but I've asked Mike Jetty and Stephen Morsette, who are Indian Education Specialists with Montana's Office of Public Instruction, to come and spend some time talking about Indian Education for All and Montana's Tribes. And we mixed it up a bit and decided we're going to do a little bit on stereotypes and sports mascots, too. So we've had a fun time all day. Good jokes. Mm-hmm. We welcome you and thank you for coming.
All right. Well, thank you for being here this afternoon. My name is Mike Jetty, member of the Spirit Lake Dakota Nation, and also the Turtle Mountain Chippewa descendant. And grew up in South Dakota, been out here in Montana for, I don't know, 20-some years now, but working with Indian Education. I used to teach on the Cheyenne River Reservation in South Dakota with the Lakota, taught at Taukini School. And when I was there, I really immersed myself in traditional Lakota culture, even though I'm in Dakota. But I'll share something with you since it's winter time. The Lakota word for potato is blow. Blow means potato in the Lakota language. And so when I was out there at Cheyenne River, you know how they keep temperatures? They take potatoes and put them outside. You wake up the next morning, if there's five potatoes froze, it's five below.
Good joke, right?
No, but thanks for being here. I get to work at OPI with Indian Education for All, doing curriculum and professional development. I get to work here with my buddy Steven. I'll let him give his intro and we'll jump right into this. So,
good afternoon. It's Steven Morissette, as Mike and Erica told informed you guys. I am from Rocky Boy, Montana, grew up in Blackfeet country, worked out on the Rocky Boy Reservation, just bordering it, Boxdale there, public schools, K-9, and actually K-12, and I taught there for 9 years. Been with OPI, with Mike Jetty, for the past year and a half, and just enjoying myself doing these kinds of presentations.
All right, Steve and I are going to mix it up, and this is for Erica. She's had to suffer through two of the same presentations. But we thought we'd do something on stereotypes and sports mascots, because all of us are aware of those issues, and we've probably all been stereotyped for some reason in our life. And so to start us off, we're going to start out with a video clip. And
is it on this?
Just click on it.
Oh, do you have to push
This is a short.
This is 2 minutes.
Proud. Forgotten. Indian. Navajo. Blackfoot. Inuit and Sioux. Survivor. Spiritualist. Patriot. Sitting Bull. Jim Thorpe, mother, father, son, daughter, chief, Apache, Pueblo, Choctaw, Chippewa, and Crow, underserved, struggling, resilient, Squanto, Red Cloud, Tecumseh, and Crazy Horse, Rancher, Teacher, Doctor, Soldier, Seminole, Seneca, Mohawk, and Creek, Mills, Will Rogers, Geronimo, Unyielding, Strong, Indomitable. Native Americans call themselves many things. The one thing they don't.
All right, so what'd you see? What'd you hear? What kind of images were in that video? Stephen and I are teachers, so we're really good at wait time and eye contact.
Thanks. Heroic.
What's that?
Heroic.
Heroic, yeah. Lots of cool images. What else?
everyday images.
Every day, just people, right? Mm-hmm. Living. What else?
Well, they're all very human images, except the last one, which was something painted on the side of a helmet, which people tend to remember.
Yeah, so very human, lots of images, lots of people, right? What were some of the tribes?
Chippewa.
Sioux.
Blackfeet.
How about some of the individuals they mentioned? Red Cloud. Who else?
Jim Thorpe.
Crazy. Anybody been to Crazy Horse Monument in South Dakota? Pretty cool. Did you know what happened last summer? They used too much dynamite and blew off Crazy Horse's hand, so they're trying to make him do this. That's an old joke in South Dakota. But no, so lots of images, right? Contemporary, historic, famous leaders. But then at the end, they hit you with this, right? Give you a little fact, though. You know that image on that helmet was made by a guy from Montana in the 1960s named Blackie Wetzel. How many of you did not know that? And so Blackfeet, he used to be president of the National Congress of American Indians. And the owner of the Redskins approached him and asked him to design a logo. And so the logo itself is culturally accurate from a Blackfeet man who put this together. But yet it's interesting, his family is really divided on this mascot issue. His grandson worked with Stephen and I in the same hallway. His office is right next door to mine. And so we have some really interesting discussions with Donnie and his dad, Don. But so I just wanted to give you that little fact that there's a Montana connection to Browning, Montana with that logo. Most people aren't aware. So a little Paul Harvey for you. That's the story. But so we thought we'd just do a little thing on mascots and stereotypes to wrap it up. But this is what Stephen and I do in our jobs at OPI. We work with teachers all across the state of Montana with Indian Education for All, and we're so glad that you came here today because you're fulfilling a state law and a constitutional obligation by being here and just checking out our presentation. So thank you for attending. One of the things that was listed in the description of what we're going to do is cover the 7 essential understandings, and I think that's the next one. Who has seen these? Do we have any cards left there? Yeah. Or do we give them all away?
No, I'm sleeping on the job.
Oh, that's all right. But we brought together representatives from every tribe in Montana, and we met, and we said, what do you want every Montana to know about you? And so these tribal leaders came up with these. And so they said, tribes are diverse. I think we have a few descriptions of these. Like the first one, you know, there's 12 tribes in Montana. They're all distinct. They're all unique. And they contribute to modern Montana. Stephen was just talking about Rocky Boy and Fort Belknap and how much they contribute to Havre's economy, right? Lots and lots of money from Native folks of this community. You know, keep it alive, keep it going. So that's that modern Montana part. You know, who are Native people today? Who are Native people to school? Thank you, students, for being here. That's cool. And so, huge amount of diversity. Everybody's distinct and unique. And so, individuals, American Indians, are a very, very diverse group. We had a great discussion on a couple of the previous presentations about this essential understanding, but anything you want to share on this one, Stephen? Well, come on. We talked a lot about stereotypes, and because just a show of hands, how many of you have heard Native stereotypes made about American Indians? All of us in here, right? How many of you experienced a stereotype yourself? Native or non-Native? You know, lots of us get stereotyped for different reasons, right? Like, Steven's a Grizz fan, and I'll stereotype him for that sometimes. I'm a Bobcat. I get stereotyped for being a Bobcat because we always lose in football, except this year.
Except this year, they got lucky, and it don't matter.
Yeah,
we'll get them back.
But, you know, so there's stereotypes about lots of groups, and, you know, I'm sure you can share examples of, in your lives. But because there's so many negative ones, we put out some images at OPI several years ago, poster series, representatives from every tribe in Montana under the age of 35. Who knows? Yeah. So you probably do, right?
Oh,
anybody related to
him? That's this guy.
But, you know...
Dustin Whitford, he was on the tribal council up in Rocky Boy, Montana. Also has Lauren Corcoran, pharmacist out of Rocky Boy. She went to the U of M's old pharmacy. And there's also several from throughout Montana's tribes on this poster series. Doctors, dentists.
Football player.
Oh yeah, football, National Football League. I don't know if you guys remember Tuff Harris, but he played for the Grizz. And then he played for Steelers and Miami Dolphins. He was a starting safety for them. Now he's doing is he doing some, do you know what he's doing for Miller's Public Schools?
Yeah.
Yeah, and a lot of motivational speaking. So it's pretty cool to see him come back home and present some positive things that are happening in his community.
Yeah. So what's cool about this series is we put this out in every school. How many of you have seen these posters in your schools? And what's neat for me, being at OPI, I get to go to schools all across the state of Montana and see these posters in Kalispell, in White Sulphur Springs, in Frenchtown, in Missoula, and Helena. And for non-native students to see these images, but what's also cool is for native students to see positive role models from all these different tribes doing cool stuff. And so, because we hear so much negative, we said, well, let's put out as many positive images out there with good messages. So, and this is a powerful essential understanding. We talk about this a lot in our curriculum. But, you know, there are songs, there are ceremonies that are thousands of years old that are still conducted, practiced, lived by people today at sacred sites, sacred lands, hills. You know, people still, you know, participate in sweat lodge ceremonies, sun dances, you know, vision quests. Powerful, powerful ceremonies connected to the land. And then, you know, then we have contemporary culture, right? Powwows, round dances, you know, all kinds of, you know, ceremonies like that. You know, how many folks have been to a powwow? Everybody in here? Right? Almost there. I sing. I sing with a couple different drum groups, and, you know, singing is a lot of fun. Any singers in here? You know, when I first started singing, they told me, Mike, we want you to sing tenor. I said, how am I going to sing higher? And they said, no, 10 or 12 miles away. But, you know, in your powwows, you know, thinking about diversity, the first time I came to Montana, I saw a female drum group. I'd never seen that before. Because where I grew up in South Dakota, usually just the men sit at the drum and the women stand behind. And so tribal diversity, I was like, wow, that's cool. And these women can really jam too. And so, you know, so there's a huge, huge amount of diversity of traditions, you know, with some tribes, with what women can do, what men can do, and it differs from tribe to tribe. And so what Stephen and I are going to talk about now is this concept of hegemony. It's like, who tells the grand narrative of the United States, of Montana? Who's telling the story? Well, this concept is prevalent throughout our country, throughout our textbooks, throughout movies, literature. But we got to think about it. It works best when you don't see it, when it's the norm, when it's just okay. But when we look at this from a historical perspective and bring it up today with, like, sports mascots, it's like peeling back the layers of an onion. You just keep going further and further into it. And so here's some examples of hegemony. Sit Indian style, sit in single file Indian style, cowboys and Indians, don't be an Indian giver. You've heard those, right? Those are, you know, interesting statements, but these are really good examples of hegemony. Westward movement, nation of immigrants, new world. Why are those hegemonic statements? Not to say they're wrong, right?
From a point of view.
From a certain perspective, right? From native perspectives, these aren't accurate at all. You know, it wasn't a Western movement. It was an Eastern invasion, right? Depending on your tribe. Didn't immigrate from anywhere. It wasn't a new world. It was just home. So that terminology we use, who's telling that story? So we're going to show you some examples of bias. And we're going to show you a movie clip. Who's seen Peter Pan? We're going to show you a cartoon from the 50s, we're going to show you some print resources, and then we're going to bring it to today. But I say, use these to teach critical literacy. And so we'll start out with the history quiz. Oh, you just gave it away.
My bad. Sorry.
Who knows where this is from?
Stephen just gave it away.
Yeah.
What are the bias words?
Savages.
Savages. Merciless. So when you read this, what's it say about all Indian people?
We're savages.
Pretty bad, huh?
Pretty bad, yeah.
Rugged. And this is not accurate at all. It's an example of historical bias, a good example of American Indians being lied about to serve a political purpose. And what document is this in?
Roll it. It flashed.
Our Declaration of Independence. Show of hands, how many of you did not know that was in there? To be honest. And so there's so many examples of this throughout our country's history. We're just going to hit on a couple. This, we just had a curriculum put out by teachers in Great Falls. Fascinating historical primary source document, the requirement. Anybody ever heard of this before? The Spanish would read this. It was put out by the Catholic Church. They would read this when they're, you know, colonizing a group. But it was wild. Self-justification for the Spanish invaders justified by religion. So go to the next one. This is what this says. So they had read this to the Indians and then said, with the help of God, we shall enter your country, make war against you in all ways, manner who can, subject you to the yoke and obedience of the church, take you, your wives, children, make slaves of them, sell and dispose of them, and as their highness may command, take away your goods, do all the mischief and damage that we can if you do not obey us. So this is what the Spanish read to the Indians when they met them, said, if you don't, you know, become Christians, we're going to just wipe you out because God says it's okay. Isn't that wild? How many of you have never seen this? And what's cool about this is an example of students in Great Falls, Montana. We had teachers put a curriculum together around some of this stuff and to see what these kids in Great Falls are getting out of it. They're learning a whole new perspective on our country's history. It's not to say we're blaming anybody today, but to take an accurate, honest, inclusive look at some of the stuff that did happen with colonization. This is from 1908. Let's flip through these, Stephen. I think there's like seven or eight of them. Here we go, one more. So you read this spelling test from 1908. This was from the graded school speller. It was used in Chicago, Boston, New York. But what were kids in elementary school learning about Indians in a spelling test? Isn't that wild? Look at that language. You see this, fiendish delight and torture. You know, we wonder why there's so many negative stereotypes about Indians, because it was taught in our schools, it's embedded in our country's foundational documents. Let's get to the next one. But do you think we've moved beyond it? Well, this is from 2010 in the New York Times bestseller, but look at this. Certain facts are inescapable. American Indians warlike by nature. So we're always fighting. Stephen and I are always fighting with each other.
Just when we don't like each other.
Yeah. But look at this. Enemies were enemies. Rules of dealing with them came through thousand years. You know, it was what everyone had always done, what the Sioux did to the black man. Torture him to death without question. Not true at all. But this is a guy who wrote a book about, you know, Indians in the South and Quan Parker. And did a lot of historical research. Well, when I read this book, I just got fired up because of all the lies, the misinformation, inaccuracies, stereotypes that was perpetuated in this thing. I'm like, New York Times bestseller. And then we get road signs. You know, you see things like hostile natives, right? And then another one. This is hostile Indian country in Shields River. There's me looking hostile.
And these are across, you know, you see these on Montana roads, but we stopped outside of, was it Shoto or Vaughn? There was one and it had the information and what is the state? Hostile Blackfeet people. Then we rolled upon past Shoto and I guess that used to be the where the tribal council met, and those borders just shrunk to now present day Blackfeet Reservation. It's interesting to see that they actually have that location as part of their history, but I don't know if you'll run into too many Native Americans over in Shoto, Montana, unless they're passing through.
There's quite a good little shell population that lived there though. Interesting.
Is there?
Yeah.
See, I wasn't aware of that because my experience with that is obviously I didn't see any other than the local Shoto played Browning basketball. So, interesting.
Yeah. All right, so we're going to watch Peter Pan. Put this in its historical context. It was made in the 1950s, right? to entertain folks. This is just a 3-minute clip, I think. But
is
watch it.
I can just click on the screen.
Click on it.
Oh, okay, yeah, it is.
I think you might have to crank up the volume. We were doing a tech run earlier.
Is that too
first time a tomahawk chop is done. Historical context, 1950s, we made just for fun, but what was in there? No reaction?
There was stereotyping.
Yeah, all kinds of stereotypes, right? And so a lot of kids in the United States and maybe around the world, that's one of the first things, images they ever see about American Indians, is through a movie that plant seeds real early. Kids in Livingston, Montana use that. 4th and 5th grade classes and talk about American Indian stereotypes. I showed that to a group of 5th graders in Livingston 2 years ago, and I said, what'd you see? And then one kid says, Indians were the first tree huggers. That was a great reaction to that. But yeah, so you can use old movies like that to talk about stereotypes, right? There's a great movie out there. It's called Real Indians. Anybody ever seen that one? Did you like it? It's really cool. Shows old school movies, goes all the way up to today, you know, Smoke Signals and all those other movies. Pretty good, it's good stuff, so check it out. All right, so now we're going to fast forward to today and mascots. There's some interesting issues with this. It's not a black and white issue. There's a lot of gray area, but there is one black and white issue Stephen and I are going to stick with here. So let's roll through these to you, okay? If we can. Oh, I love this cartoon. Drew's grandpa sent us outside to play Cowboys versus Indians. Makes no sense at all. Well, credit to you, your generation. One's a football team, the other's a baseball team. What do they play? Scrabble? So, you know, perspectives, right? I like that one. And so, maybe the new generations are growing up thinking about these things a different way. I hope so. This is from the Chronicle of Higher Ed from now 16 years ago. All my resources are getting old. But these guys flip it in either or. They say supporters, they honor indigenous people. To those who oppose mascots, they give life to racial stereotypes, revive historical patterns of appropriation and oppression. Remember Essential Understanding 3, talking about traditions, beliefs, spirituality, ceremonies, very sacred, powerful things. But yet, with these mascots, you see cultural appropriation and it blows your minds. All right. So as of just 3 years ago, there was over 2,000 schools across the United States that had Indian mascots. In 2001, the Commission on Civil Rights said to get rid of them by non-Native schools. I thought that was interesting, because this is where we're getting the gray area. What's Browning's mascot?
Indians.
What about Lodgegrass?
Warriors.
Indians. What about Arlie?
Warriors.
Poplar?
Indians.
So schools on any reservations, what do you think? Yeah? Because that's who you are? But wouldn't it be cool, I was down in Lodgegrass telling folks this, I was like, Lodge, anybody know what the Crow call themselves in their own language? Mzalik. Mzalik. You heard that before? How about the Blackfeet? What's one of the words they call themselves?
Pukani.
Pukani, yeah. Why be the Browning Indians when you could be the Browning Pukani or the Lodgegrass Exalica? A school on a reservation, use your word in your own language. A Salish word for warrior instead of warrior. Plenicu, you know, use a word for warrior in a Crow language. Wouldn't that be cool? It's kind of like what Fort Belknap did with their Chama College, right? It used to be Fort Belknap College, and now what is it? Yeah, you know, named after the tribe. You know, so cultural revitalization, taking things back, taking cultural ownership, saying, hey, let's name it after ourselves in our own languages. I think that would be cool if schools on reservations that have Native mascots did that. So maybe it'll happen someday. All right. But then there's this. And Sports Illustrated did a big story. This is like 20 years ago. But this is the Seminole mascot, and I say, what did the Seminoles do? What did Florida State do? Anybody know?
They made lots of money.
They made lots of money.
They paid money for the tribe every year to keep the peace.
So they give money to the tribe. The Seminole tribe in Florida gave Florida State permission to use them as their mascot. Florida State approached them, said, can we use you? So that's a good positive step, right? And then students at Florida State are supposed to learn about Seminole history and culture. Well, you know what's funny? Oklahoma has Seminoles. Their tribal council voted against the mascot. And so that's interesting. Utah did something. What's Utah's mascot?
Utes.
The Utes. They approached the Ute Tribal Council. And at that time, the Ute Tribal Council said, yes, you can use us as your mascot, but educate your students about us. And so there's that where a university at least is going and asking permission, which I think that's pretty positive.
But has anybody ever watched Florida State Seminole basketball or football team on TV?
Mm-hmm.
What's common there for during breaks, during the game? There's always something happening.
Like a song.
Yeah. And a chant, like tomahawk chop.
Yeah.
And everybody in the stadium takes part in, if they're a Florida State fan, this, that, you know, to me it's like a lot of people believe that's how Native Americans are. I had that happen here locally. I had a kid in high school that, you know, did a tomahawk chop during a Browning Indians versus Havre Blue Ponies game, and it was like, to me it was insulting, so I turned around and told him to stop, so, because I didn't like it. I was the one that was a sophomore in high school. You know, they see that on national TV with Kansas City Chiefs. They see that with Atlanta Braves. Braves is not an insulting name. The Redskins take part in that. But the name in itself is an insult. Redskin.
Yeah, that chop, though. You've heard it, right? Whoa, 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 But when you hear 60,000 fans doing that, it sounds crazy. I mean, it's like it probably intimidates the other team. But from that, what Steven says, from a cultural perspective, that's not an honorable thing at all, right? Maybe they could play the Seminole flag song at the beginning of the game instead of doing that stupid chop, right? Rethink what they're doing if they really want to honor.
Do you have the video from the California school?
Yeah, I got it.
I didn't know if that was on
here. I'm always updating this with new videos, and we'll show you some new stuff. But this is the one that has to go. This is the one that's the most offensive. Their own dictionaries. Merriam-Webster says it's usually offensive. Random House Dictionary says it's often disparaging and offensive. Red Lodge, Montana. High school football students started a movement there. They used to be known as the Red Lodge Redskins. They changed their mascot to the Rams. Their principal told me the story about their football team, their coach doing, "Let's go Redskins," and the students refused to say it. And these guys said, "We don't think this is an honorable term. We don't want to be known by this anymore." And so they worked to change their mascot. Their high school principal said he had never seen school board meetings so packed. And he said there was just divisions in the community, people so connected to that mascot. But the students said, "No, we think this is offensive." And they changed it. And so, way to go, Red Lodge, Montana. And so, but yet in our nation's capital, they still can't do it. There's a whole history behind this too. George Preston Marshall, the owner of the Redskins back in the 40s, was a racist. He was a blatant racist. He was the last NFL owner to let African Americans play. And he actually, they held a KKK rally in Washington, D.C., where these white supremacists marched around saying, "Keep the Redskins white." Isn't that bizarre? But, you know, the history of that word, the word is just as offensive, and I apologize for saying this, nigger. Anybody offended by the word nigger? The word redskin is just as offensive as that N-word, but because of cultural hegemony, we've been so desensitized to it, we're okay with it. And that's that cultural hegemony at its worst. And so this name needs to go away. Some folks will say, "Oh, we got bigger issues to deal with." Yes, we do. Let's change this name and get on to deal with them. Mm-hmm. So that has got to go. But the next slide. These guys did a whole bunch of research on this. When did folks use it? Nowhere in any historical document have these folks found the word Redskin to be used in a positive connotation. They say it's an honorable term to honor Native folks. But would you, the next one, Steve. Thanks. Look at this. You know, state reward for dead Indians has been increased to $200 for every Redskin sent to purgatory. So they're having bounties after the 1862 uprising in Minnesota. Adolf Hitler used the term Redskin talking about the Russians. Germanized this country by the immigration of Germans and to look upon the natives as the Redskins. And so you look at that, it's like, that's powerful stuff. But yet, you know, it's still okay to use this in our, you know, vernacular in American society because it's an honorable term. But would you use that? Say you have a Cree elder in here. Would you say, would you offer up a prayer, you know, "You look like a very honorable Redskin"? Or would you go to a powwow and say, "Boy, those Redskins can sure dance"? Or would you come back from a ceremony and say, "I saw these Redskins do a ceremony, it was powerful"? Would you use that? Would you refer to the Native, would you refer to the Redskins here as Redskins? No. But here's an interesting thing now. How many folks have used, heard Native folks use the word skin with each other, right? It's kind of like how African Americans have used the word N, the N-word for themselves. You know, negative word, but taking ownership of it just to kind of, you know, use the word. There's even a movie called Skins. Anybody seen that one? Powerful film. And so, you know, there's a lot of different ways to look at this word, but that football team needs to change its name because it just is offensive. Here's the old fight song, you know, raised on a warpath, scalp them, swamp them. So they switched it, they took out some of that, but they still talked about being on the warpath and all this stuff. Excellent. And so there's just this huge movement to change that mascot, and eventually it will change once we educate the general population. The current owner of the Washington Redskins, his name is Dan Snyder, says he will never change it, but guaranteed, I bet you he'll have to eventually. But they even have a Blackfeet man working as a consultant who is a diehard fan of that team. And he's, you know, on the inside of that organization trying to say, let's keep this. They did a big survey that said 9 out of 10 natives think it's okay. But the thing with that survey is the folks that took that survey could self-identify. And so you know, if you're not an Indian, you could say, well, I'm an Indian, and still take that survey and it would count, which is pretty wild. So that's that. So, but look at this. This is a school. Let's just go to this one. This is in California, the Spirit Band. And this is from last year.
Have Connie, the Redskin princess, and they're doing their spirit dance right now. It's pretty amazing. I'm going to be quiet and just let you listen to her watch for a second.
What you're seeing is our Redskin princess doing our traditional spirit dance.
How long have you guys been doing that? It looks pretty amazing, and of course the students are all involved. They're excited, it looks like.
Well, it's part of our Redskin tradition.
Go ahead,
we've been Redskins for almost 100 years now. At one point it used to be called our war dance,
right.
But together and working with our local...
So when you see that, what do you think? Would you see that at the powwow here? But yet, you know, that is a non-Indian school and says they're living by some tribes, but, you know, that gal comes out there doing that dance and they do the chop.
That so was live on a LA station, California, which is bizarre to me because there are a lot of native people in California. There's a lot of tribes, there's a lot of reservations in California, but... you know, they allowed that to happen, that honorable dance.
Yeah. Pretty wild. So. If there was a local tribe, maybe bring them in and have a cultural celebration that way, right?
Mm-hmm.
Make it authentic instead of doing that goofy thing. Look at this next one. This is in South Dakota. And this is from last year. They have the red men, and they have non-native students dress up as Indians, paint Sundance symbols on their bodies, have a vision quest as Medicine Man selects the homecoming court. The local tribes in South Dakota have asked them to stop doing this. Well, look at these guys. Got their little, you know, outfits on, and this guy's got a headdress, and supposedly one of these dudes had a vision quest and decided who was going to be the homecoming king and queen. You know, they don't see this as being offensive. They just think they're having fun. That's that cultural hegemony. In action with mascots. Now, I'm sure these are all nice kids, but yet they've been so desensitized, so accustomed to these stereotypes that the teachers, the administrators, the school board, the parents don't get it. And that's why we have things like Indian Education for All to teach them. Next one. We could keep the name, but just change the logo. Right? Name in a certain context isn't offensive at all. All right. But look at this. This is, 4 years ago now. Philadelphia fan at a game. And when I see that, if I were to walk around with the head of an African American on a noose, would I get in trouble? Walk across campus that way? You know, I'd get in big trouble. This happened in our country's history. Sand Creek Massacre. Calvary rode through the streets of Denver with the heads of Cheyenne on their bayonets. And so when I see this stuff, this is reenacting a painful moment in our country's history. But yet this guy's having a good time at his game, not even thinking that this is a real people. And so what if we had the Blackskins and the Zulu Chiefs? I don't know. Maybe. Maybe not. This is from Oklahoma for a football game. Hey, Indians, get ready to leave in a trail tears round two. And so this is a school playing a school with an Indian mascot. When I see this, this is as offensive as, hey, Jewish people, get ready for a new Holocaust. Right? Trail of Tears was a horrific crime against humanity. But yet, the cheerleaders, the parents, the coaches, the school, they've become so, you know, whatever, they're unaware because of the cultural hegemony that they think this is okay. Next one. And then this guy, you know, Chief Wahoo. There's a big movement in Cleveland now called Change the Chief. You know, I'm not offended by the word Indian. You know, it's just a name that's a label. It's not accurate, right? But yet they said if they really want to be named that, maybe hire a Native American artist. Put something that's accurate and honorable on there instead of the goofy chief. But I go to powwows a lot, and I see a lot of singers with this on their hats. You know, maybe that's taking ownership of it or whatever. But next one. But then there's folks like this that dress up, paint their faces, put on fake headdresses, and do the chop and whoop around. That's where I take offense. That's where I was like, that's cultural appropriation. I can't dress up, paint my face black, and put on an Afro wig and some leopard skins and be an African American, can I? Probably not. But these guys think it's okay. This is from Iowa. Basketball team from this year. This is from this fall. The Indians basketball team, 2016, and so these girls dressed up, natives, dancing around a totem pole at the basketball hoop, whooping and hollering, and in theory, they're supposed to be honoring native people with this mascot, when in fact they're perpetuating cultural stereotypes of the worst kind, right? Warriors. Mascot is actually named after their first postmaster, whose name was Savage. Why couldn't they have been Savage Postmasters? It sounds fierce. We got the Indians, blacks, Jews, Chinese. What about this one now? Next one. Oh, yeah, I forgot about this. This is from a couple years ago. Look at that. Kansas City Chiefs, scalp the Redskins, feed them whiskey, and send them to the reservation. About a sign. Then it's this kind of stuff. You chop. Mm-hmm. Here's another one. I think this is from Oklahoma. Send them home. Trail of Tears.
Well, that happened again this fall at, I'm not sure the school, but I saw it at Macon National Headlines, where they referred to the Trail of Tears as being the opponent, you know.
Yeah.
No different than, you know, comparing what happened here, in the United States. It was similar to the Holocaust in the 1940s and earlier. So if we want to look at, there's actually an interesting thing on, they at U of M, they did a, looking at the parallels of what's happened to the native people in the United States and compared it to the Holocaust and the Jewish people. They, that's really what they started terming it. And it happens over in Missoula, but I think they moved it to Billings this year. It's called Building Bridges, and it looks at the parallels from what happened to the Jewish and the tribal people of Americas. And it's very interesting, and it details a lot more information. If you guys want to join that group, you have to just search it, Building Bridges. You have to apply for it. It's like a week-long course, but you get a whole different perspective on what really took place in America. It's interesting. I only took one day of it because I was presenting down there, but I'm hoping this summer. I was supposed to go last August or July, late July, but I mean, my son was born. I had a new baby boy. And, I wasn't able to attend. This year, I'm hoping.
Go to the next one.
Next one?
Yeah. Who's heard of these guys? Fighting Whiteys.
Did you want to show this video?
Yeah, you're going to have to turn the sound down, but click on this guy. Has anybody heard of these guys?
Click on him?
Yeah, and then the volume is going to be really loud.
Big question this hour, who are the Fighting Whiteys? What kind of a name is that for a sports team? Well, think about it for a moment. Most of us were brought up with teams named the Redskins and the Braves and the Indians without giving it a second thought. Well, now a group of Native American students from the University of Northern Colorado are protesting a nearby high school's use of the name Fighting Red by naming their own intramural team the Fighting Whiteys. They're not their first ones to cry foul over how sports teams are named. And joining us now with his take on this and some other issues involving sports and race, Once again, Keith Olman. He's back.
How about this? Is this a stroke of genius to call for these guys to call themselves this name? We, for years, have been hearing how, you know, if a team were called the Washington Brownskins, there would be protests outside the stadium and barricades. They'd never get a game played. But for this intramural team in Colorado to call themselves the Fightin', and that's no G on the, notice that.
Oh, fighting, I didn't say that right.
Fightin' Whiteys is a complete role reversal. It is like assuming the, you know, the other gender role in a class somewhere. And I think the point is being made here, how offensive this can be, how the names that we have, as you said, grown up with, Indians, Braves, Redskins, Chiefs, how offensive they can be.
So how offensive is this to people in Colorado right now?
I'm not getting the big sense that because an intramural team is making this protest that it's going to resolve the entire issue even within the state of Colorado, to say nothing about the entire world of sports, but I think that the attention that's being paid nationally is suddenly putting everybody who has never thought about this in the position of being the offended party, which is, of course, the best way you affect social change.
Yeah.
2 points to make. One, the Fighting Whiteys, their slogan is, everything's going to be all white. I swear that's on their t-shirt. We also got an email about them. Viewer writes in saying, the Fighting Whiteys, I love it. I'm a white man. I think that is one of the greatest team nicknames ever. If we as a nation are ever to fully embrace our diversity, we must accept the fact that we are different colors, backgrounds, and culture.
Does the National Football League have anything to say about the Washington Redskins and the name of that team? And this isn't the first time that that's been brought up.
No, it's been a point of contention since they were the Boston Redskins in 1937. That is the most offensive name because it is a pejorative nickname.
Sure.
As opposed to, you know, you can say the Braves honored to some degree, you know, great moments in Native American history, or even the Chiefs. And there are a lot of Native Americans, a big poll in Sports Illustrated, which they polled Native Americans, and only about half of them are even concerned about them. But Redskins, people have been calling that team the Fighting Punkies. Yeah.
And the NFL hasn't said a whole lot about it, have they?
No, there's marketing issues. It's
like
a business story.
The ever-present marketing issues. Where have you heard that before?
Well, Fighting Whiteys, what's fascinating about this is an intramural basketball team. They made the Today Show, they made CNN because these Native American guys chose generic white guy as their mascot. And so, and then there's another clip, we're not going to have time to show it, but it shows this young African American girl in the stands at a basketball game saying, here we go, Whiteys, here we go. And you can tell she's just having fun with that, you know, because she's probably heard stereotypes in her life, you know, and so she gets to go cheer on her buddies at intramural games and root for the Fighting Whiteys. So, how do you affect social change? I think those guys made a good statement there. And then go to the next one, Steve. What's cool is we've seen students research this issue. And I mentioned Livingston, Montana. The next slide shows what these fifth grade students in Livingston did. They did a little poster series around mascots. They did some artwork, but then they said no. They did racist impressions of sports mascots. They did research on it. So these are fifth grade students learning about this, saying we need to move beyond these. And to me, that gives me hope. And so, you know, but not all mascots are created equal. They don't all have to go away, but I think we need to rethink them and rethink what we do. And so it's just an interesting topic for discussion, isn't it? A lot of diverse perspectives. And I know, I think that was our final slide, but we're going to open it up. What's that?
There's one more.
Oh, one more.
Quote from Daryl Kipp.
Oh, yeah. Thanks for including this. Anybody know who Daryl Kipp is? Wow, a powerful individual, passed away a few years ago. I had the fortune of hanging out with him a little bit. But this is what it's all about. This is why Stephen and I do what we do in our jobs. And if you're a teacher, I think this is what you do in your job, is to, you know, have a more inclusive history about our country. Because we're all Montanans, no matter who we are. We're all Americans. We're all just people. And we all need to realize that and come together, understand our differences and our commonalities, but know that we all have to share this place, right? And it's home for all of us now, regardless of how we got here, we're here now. So Daryl Kipp, man, powerful individual revitalizing the Blackfeet language. So, any final comments, questions?
Yeah. Mike, one thing you didn't mention, most of the stereotypes that you saw were negative, but James Fenimore Cooper, who was one of the big authors in 19th century, wrote the concept of the noble savage, and he wrote The Last of the Mohegans, and the problem with it was that he wrote all of his novels in a hotel room in New York. He got ideas of what the natives were like by listening to letters, and the problem wasn't just that he had influence here, he sold wildly in Europe, so people got the idea that that's what natives were like, and it's caused a lot of irreparable hell, because at least we have some discussions here, but there's people in Europe who still believe this kind of stuff. And that noble savage, he tried to say in all of his books, look, they're all wonderful people, they're big, strong, they're heroic. And the irony is that you're people like we are. There are some strong ones, there are some weak ones, there's some good ones, and there's some bad ones. He did as much negative by trying to be positive as what you're seeing for the negative stereotypes. People either believe one or the other, they just don't get the idea that they're humans.
Yeah, the whole human perspective was encompassed, right? For all those different tribes, for any cultural group. You're all not bad, you're all not good, exactly.
He had a period of about 40 years where no one else wrote, and he did. Everybody read it and said, well, that's really great. They didn't think it any more offensive than looking at the Washington Redskins. It was just accepted.
Yeah, exactly. Last of the Mohicans, I just rewatched that again. Daniel Day-Lewis and, what's his name? I'm looking right at him. Magua. Played him. Really cool actor. Anyway, it was just fun to watch that again, thinking about some of that stuff. Great story, but you know, you put it in this historical context. You know, thanks so much for coming. Do you feel like you got something out of it? You know, different perspective. Right? So yeah, one more comment.
I do have one question, because it seems it caught my attention a little bit that so many teams adopted those types of mascots. What was it that caused them to want to have that mascot?
Because they admired the Indian fighting spirit.
Yes.
Because you want your mascot to be fierce.
So can't we turn that into something good?
I think there's an opportunity. I think there is. And so, but yet it's truly honoring. So say those schools with Indian mascots actually bring drum groups, actually become exemplars of Indian Ed for All, and do cultural studies. I think that's maybe where these could lead, but I haven't seen it yet. At least it's only in a few small instances. But I'll leave you with one last story. I'll tell you this, Erica hasn't heard this yet, and Steven's heard this, and we'll finish right at 5. How's that sound? Those three guys I'm hiking, a Blackfeet, a Crow, and a Lakota guy. They're hiking in the mountains, and it's in the springtime, and they come across this raging river. They don't know how to get across. And so the Crow man takes out tobacco, and he puts out tobacco. Creator, give me the tools, give me the strength to get across this river. Poof, he gets these big muscles on his arms and legs, and he hops in that river and starts swimming. Almost drowns, but he makes it, crawls up on the bank, exhausted. Blackfeet friend's watching this, so he puts out tobacco. Creator, give me the tools to get across this river. Poof, he gets a canoe and a paddle, hops in that river, starts paddling. Canoe smashes up on some rocks. He crawls up on the shore by his Crow friend, but he makes it. Lakota guy's watching this. He puts out tobacco. Creator, give me the intelligence to get across this river. Poof, turns into a Lakota woman. She pulls out her GPS and finds a bridge. Well, thanks so much. Thank you, Erica. And thank you for all hanging in here until 5 o'clock. So.
Thank you all for coming. We had almost 60, I think, throughout the day. We had a packed house this morning, and it's wonderful. We're going to keep bringing them back. They have really great stuff. We could have kept going.
Which is an entirely different presentation we presented. It wasn't about the Redskins. It was more about what resources are available for Montana teachers. And we'd like to share it with you guys if you guys are willing to come up again. I think maybe there's a chance we'll be doing another presentation in the future.
There is. 100%.
All right, cool.
This was a little bit different than the two presentations this morning. They decided to switch it up a little bit, but I think it was all really good conversation and good things for Northern. So, thank you.
Mix it up.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
All right.
Enjoy your evening.
Yeah.